Good morning. It's nice to be back. We got stuck in Tucson when our engine blew up, but they've got I got a new one. It was under warranty. And also, while we were away, I joined the Octogenarian Club, so who knew? Well, there was this little girl one day sitting in the kitchen watching her mother do some stuff at the counter. She said, Mom, you have a couple of white hairs. What is that? She said, well, every time you do something wrong or you make me cry or make me unhappy, I get a new white hair. And she said, ooh, Grammy's hairs are all white. The other one said, Mom, what's it like to have the best daughter in the world? She said, I don't know. You're going to have to ask your grandmother. Let us pray. Dear Lord, with your power, nothing is impossible. With spirits raised and hearts trusting, we are grateful for your promise that when two or more are gathered, you are there among them. We thank you for the opportunity to gather in your holy presence once more. We ask that you would bless our worship service today. May you fill us with wisdom to understand your will, and after this service, may you help make us instruments for your greater purpose. These things we ask in the holy name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And since the music or the words are up so high, why don't we, if you can, please stand and join me in For the Beauty of the Earth.
For the beauty of the earth, for the glory of the skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For the wonder of each hour, of the day and of the night, hill and vale and tree and flower, sun and moon and stars at night, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For the joy of human love, brother, sister, parent, child, friends on earth and friends above, for all gentle thoughts and mild, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise.
Please be seated.
Except for the women.
Whoop. Already?
I didn't want you to have to get up twice. I'd like to honor all of you on this day. So happy Mother's Day, happy Sister Day, happy Aunt Day, happy grandmother and grandparents or whatever. This is your Mother's Day. And I wrote this prayer for all of you. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Good morning, Father. On this day, we acknowledge the importance of mothers as we give thanks that you are a loving parent to us all. On this Mother's Day, we are reminded that you, Father, is more than a father to us. You are our mother. You have nurtured us in unconditional love. You wept with us and mourned our losses. You have rejoiced with us. Today, we rejoice in and hold on to the fact that you never forget us. No matter our circumstances, we are never forgotten by you today on Mother's Day. We give thanks to all aunts, cousins, grandmothers, and great-grandmothers. Remind us, Father, to live with a childlike faith to every instruction, obedient to your every command, and willing to share with every one of your children. We give you thanks, who is a loving mother and father to us all, and whose name we pray. Hear our prayers this day in your name, and we all say, Amen.
I'm going to be reading from 2 Corinthians 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. This is the word of the Lord.
All right, so this next hymn is I Am a Woman, so I shouldn't make any jokes. Just the women are going to be standing and singing for this one, okay? But if you're feeling feminine today, please join in.
Blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Please be seated.
We're going to pray for the offering. Lord Jesus, as the rain waters the earth, to nourish it, to make it green as we embark on a new season, it refreshes. Lord, you've been so gracious to us. May what we offer back to you from what you had entrusted to us and blessed us with, may it be for the advancement of your kingdom and the transformation of lives, both ours and those we seek to minister to. It's in the name of Christ I pray. Amen.
Check mic.
Good morning. Let me pray for us, for the word. Lord Jesus, speak to us. Each of us would not be here except for a mother through a process that you crafted that takes a while. But we're grateful. We're grateful for moms. We work on our hearts as we work through these passages of Scripture. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Well, I sent the passage, 2 Corinthians 5:17. She's already laughing, and Betty's like, you do know it's Mother's Day. It's like, yeah. She's like, I'm sure you'll work it in somehow. We want to honor the Scripture. We want to honor moms. But I want to make the point today that God has specifically crafted women, moms, hardwired into who you are, parallel with all of creation, which he said was very good. Let me explain. Genesis 1:11. Then God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants, and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds. And it was so. On to verse 12. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kind. And God saw it was good. Do you hear the theme? Because if you read the Old Testament, seed is very important because eventually it will talk about Abraham's seed, which leads to the line of Jesus. And he protected that all the way through. But from the very first chapter of Genesis, seed is important. And he put that within the plants and the fruits and the vegetables that he might do creation, and then the process might continue. Then he says to Adam when he's made, when he's created, Genesis 1:29, then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the earth, the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for food. And to the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air and all the creatures that move on the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. At verse 31, God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. Now, it is interesting. I'm not a vegetarian, but at this point, apparently they were. They hadn't started eating animals. They missed out on barbecue, which is a really sad thing for them. I don't know what you're doing for brunch, but barbecue, you know, or fajitas, my favorite. So you see that God created the plants, the fruit, even the weeds. They all have seeds, those doggone dandelions. They blow up, and every one of those little things is a seed. When a woman is born, she has 1 to 2 million eggs already in her. By the time she hits puberty, 10,000 are left. Now, I will be sensitive because there are scenes in the Bible of those who could not have children or could not have children for a while. We see Hannah. We see Sarah. Sarah laughs. Sarah laughs at God. And God said, why did she laugh? She said, I didn't laugh. He goes, yes, you did. Completely parallel to the passage in Genesis is the way God created women. That's special. That's specific, and that's divine, and that's very special. The parallel of creation is hardwired by God into women. It's creation and recreation. Along that theme of seed, by the way, Deuteronomy 22:9, this is for if you're a Bible nerd. God said, do not plant two kinds of seed in your vineyard. Don't mix them. If you do, not only the crops you plant, but the fruit of the vineyard will be defiled. Why? He didn't want them fighting, two different kinds to fight over the nourishment. Very interesting. Second thing I would say is this. No other way but by a woman. We see Jesus speaking with Nicodemus in John chapter 3. He says, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and of spirit. Now here it seems spirit means surrendering your life to Christ, but water, some would say it's baptism, but others would say that's probably the water of childbirth. So you have to be born as a human and then be born in the spirit. There's no other way. There's not a side route. This is God's design. Flesh gives birth to flesh, John 3:6. But the spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So is everyone born of the spirit. Then Nicodemus asks a brilliant question for one of the smartest men in all Israel. How do I enter my mother's womb a second time? How is that supposed to work? You see, it's very interesting because I think in our day and age, a lot of people are playing God. We want to make fruit and vegetables without seed because, of course, watermelon seeds are annoying, but then you would never have that spitting contest, would you? We want to make it to benefit us when we don't see the created order of it. We live in a day and age where no longer, apparently, I'm told, I've read, that it's not just women having children. Can I tell you that's plain God? That's not God's design. He had a specific plan and role for moms. Why do you think all the pro athletes always say, "Hi, Mom"? Now, at this point, I want to pause and say this. Perhaps you grew up in a situation with a mom that was injurious towards you. No parent is perfect. I've said to my friends who don't have children, start saving for the counseling now. You're going to do something to damage them. You're learning to be a parent. That's why, you know, a lot of times the oldest is the quietest. Because you're learning. By the end, you're worn out. Can you tell I'm the youngest? Oh, yeah. It is true. All of human life was intended to come through the woman. Even Christ, from the womb of Mary, an immaculate conception, but he still chose to follow the created order that God put in place. Amazing. And when you think about Christ coming in the form of a human and still having to do time in the womb, it's very interesting. As a baby forms. From the fall, the pain of childbearing was increased. So no women got to have a free pass there. Eve could have, apparently, if they had just left the dadgum fruit alone. But that's one of the byproducts of the fall. What about the prayers of a mother? I can speak to this personally. The love of a mother, the pain of a mother, but the prayers of a mother. My mom would give me verses. I grew up in a Christian home, but I was stubborn. I stood in those churches in Oklahoma, and I fought the Lord. I fought the Lord with an undying persistence. But my mother's prayers won out. And she would talk to me with regularity. When are you going to follow Christ? Doesn't it make sense to follow Christ? When are you going to give your life to Christ? Can I say this to most of you now, grandparents? Have that discussion. Whether with your grown children or your grandchildren or some of you great-grandchildren, when are you going to follow Christ? Pray for them. Now, the intersection of my mom's prayers and a friend of mine losing his life when he was 15 through a unique and rare disease is what triggered me. But I can tell you, I stood at the invitation hymn, because we had those in Oklahoma, you know, "Just As I Am" and "I Surrender All." And I was a liar every Sunday because I sang them. I didn't mean it. But the Holy Spirit was working on me. I was just thinking as I was sitting there, coming to Christ for me was kind of scary. What does this mean? Going into the water and being baptized, a little humiliating. Everybody was watching. But on the other side, the treasures and blessings. Incredible. Have the conversation. Moms, grandmas, great-grandmas. Be specific. Pray. Is it any wonder that when Jesus talks about prayer and the unjust judge, that there is a persistent female going after him? "Give me justice." And he said, "Not because I fear God, but because she's wearing me out. I'm going to give her justice." God says, pray like that. Is it any wonder that the first person Jesus appears to after resurrection was a female? Because we guys would have screwed it up. We would have done something boneheaded, I know. Women, it's hardwired into you, the creation. God has a specific path and a specific plan for you. I remember sitting in seminary, J.I. Packer, who wrote Knowing God, was one of my professors. And a girl dared to ask the question. It was a large classroom. Dr. Packer, as a woman, I don't really feel represented in the Trinity. Well, I went, ooh, here it comes. He's going to drop the hammer. And he said, young woman, I think it's clear from the biblical text that the Lord, as a hen gathers its chicks under its wing, that is his desire for mankind. And then he went on and put her in her place. The Holy Spirit is described as a helpmate, which is exactly that of a woman. And today is a day to honor moms and to honor women. So now about this new creation idea. Giving some encouragement, let me give you one exhortation. I had this conversation before church. Paul writes, so from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. And this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us a ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting sins against us. It is Mother's Day. We want to honor you. But I want to give you an exhortation. Perhaps it's a spiritual gift of the wrong kind. Moms, ladies, the old is gone. The new has come. I know that mothers are often taken advantage of, not thanked, left to cook or clean or different things in the household. In fact, I was in a situation at a large family gathering where, as a man, I was told, get out of the kitchen. Now, I'm a pretty good cook. Homemade salsa, chicken fajita, I can cook. This person who would fit into this age category said, ladies, come do your jobs. That was a female to females. But I was kicked out of the kitchen because just my way of thinking is we serve together. But knowing that a lot of moms carry bitterness, carry a lack of appreciation with them a long time. Sometimes it's almost like holding a grudge is a spiritual gift of the wrong kind. And moms, I want to say to you, some kids didn't know better. And they grew up and they're still not the most intelligent. But this passage about new creation says the old has gone, the new has come. And that's not just trying to broad brush it and make you feel better. But I want to exhort you today that if there's something that has been covering up the new creation parts, spring is coming and things are starting to pop through the soil. Could that be today on Mother's Day what Christ would do in you as perhaps you let something go? In a conversation before church, I was sharing that my brother who passed away in December, his birthday was yesterday. And my mom is still holding on to some things against my sister and I. And the difficulty is she lives with her. Still holding on. And the conversation will be, I understand you're grieving, but do you want to at least forgive us so that part of your heart can heal? Moms, don't let the new creation be covered up. an exhortation. Maybe your mother is no longer living or you no longer have contact. Work through it with the Lord. He is very gracious. He is very gracious. Let's pray. Lord, I'm sure that right now hearts and minds are all over the spectrum in relation to our mothers. In a group this size, I'm sure at least one or two said, well, you didn't grow up with my mother, and I could say that as well. Thank you for the specific design you've created for women, for mothers and grandmothers and great-grandmothers. In our current culture, there's an assault on male masculinity and on motherhood itself. Lord, help us to have pure hearts towards you. May we celebrate moms and grandmas today. We love you. It's in the name of Christ I pray. Amen. And we'll recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
There we are. Remain seated as we prepare for communion and join together in singing, Come Share the Lord.
We gather here in Jesus' name. His love is burning in our hearts like living flame. For through the loving Son, the Father makes us one. Come take the bread, come drink the cup, come share the Lord. He joins us here, he breaks the bread. The Lord who pours the cup is risen from the dead. The one we love the most is now our gracious host. Come take the bread, come drink the cup, come share the Lord.
As we come to the table, as that verse said, the old is gone, the new has come. If you're in Christ, experience that today at the table. Reconciliation with the Lord, perhaps reconciliation with family members when we leave here. But for now, with the Lord. Let me pray for us. Jesus, where would we be except for your sacrifice? Still enemies of God, traveling in our own path, groping about as those in the darkness, as you say. But you have made a way to the Father, the only way to the Father. And so we're grateful. And with the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, we pray now. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed.
And for our closing hymn, if you're able, please stand and join me in singing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
I know we have some that are with family due to Mother's Day. Would you do this as a benediction? Would you bless a woman today? Just bless them. Say to them, you are created in God's image. May you be blessed. Because I don't want, there are some that were not mothers, and that's okay. Sometimes that's maybe God's providence. But so our benediction today, bless a woman. Have a great day.